نحمده ونصلم على رسوله الكريم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد صدق الله العظيم. This is Surah Ikhlas, and the Surah was revealed on the Holy Prophet peace be upon him in his Meccan life in early times of his prophethood. The surah was basically revealed in the rejection of the idol worshippers of Mecca. You know that Meccans used to do idol worshipping, and there were around 360 idols kept inside or in the surroundings of the Holy Kaaba. When Holy Prophet peace be upon him was given prophethood and he proclaimed Tawheed, so Meccans asked Holy Prophet peace be upon him that what kind of being is he who alone is enough for everything. There was a problem with Meccans that they used to compare Allah with human beings. And they used to think that as a human cannot do so many things alone, but he needs assistance of others if the work is too much. So similarly, they thought that Allah alone cannot run the entire universe. Because there are so many creations, there are so many different offices to run. So they believed that though Allah is the supremest authority, but Allah has kept these idols as his assistants. And according to their assumptions, the idols were doing different things. Some of the idols were appointed for some tribes, and some of the idols were appointed for some other tribes. Some of the idols were managing their reign, and some of the idols managing their trade, and like that, they divided the different jobs amongst the different idols. And Holy Prophet peace be upon him came and said that Allah is the one and only God, and everything is happening according to the will of Allah, according to the planning of Allah. So they ask the Holy Prophet peace be upon him, can you tell us the essence of that being who alone is enough for everything? So in the reply of their question, Allah sent down Surah Ikhlas. Basically, this surah is the introduction of God. Allah defined himself in the surah. And in the beginning of the surah, Allah is saying, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. Muhammad tell them that Allah is the one and only God. The main theme of the surah is one and only God, it's Tawheed, which is the most repeated theme of the Holy Quran. And it is such an important theme that almost one third of the Holy Quran lays emphasis on this single concept. The entire religion of Islam is standing on one concept, and that is the concept of Tawheed. And this is the only surah of the Holy Quran which talks about nothing but Tawheed. That is the speciality of the surah, that there is no other topic is discussed. It is all about oneness and unity of Allah. In other surahs, there is Tawheed, but there are some other things discussed. But this surah especially talks about nothing but oneness and unity of God. So that is why it is also known as Ikhlas, the surah which purifies our belief in Tawheed. And in this surah, Allah proved his Tawheed by mentioning a very unique attribute, that is As-Samad. Allah is saying Allahu As-Samad, that Allah is an absolute being. Allah is saying that the word As-Samad is described by Mufassirin in different ways, but one of the very good description is that Samad is one who depends on no one, but all other beings depend on him at the same time. Allah is not in need of anyone's assistance. Allah is not in need of any marital relationship. Allah is not in need of any kind of rest, any kind of food or rest. So that is the absolutism of Allah, that he depends on no one. But at the same time, all of us and all other creations depend on Allah for their survival. So that is the meaning of As-Samad. The word Samad can also be described as the being who is free from all kinds of weaknesses. Nothing is weak in Allah, but all the good qualities are perfectly present in God. His knowledge is perfect. His authority is perfect. His life is perfect. And no weakness can be there in God. So this is the test of Allah, this is the test of God, that if any being has any kind of weakness in it, so that being cannot be as God. So Allah is the only one who is absolute, who is perfect in all ways. The word Samad is also used in Arabic literature for the person who was the head of the tribe, and all the people of the tribe used to take their problems, their issues to that person, and he used to listen to all of them and he used to solve them. So Allah called himself the Samad. So Allah is the Samad of the entire universe. All creations, wherever they are and whatever the problem they have, they go back to Allah. Allah listens to all of them at the same time. and Allah has the powers to solve their issues and their problems. Wherever they are, they get their problems solved whenever they ask Allah for help. So this is such a unique quality of Allah which cannot be found in any other being, and such unique qualities make Him the one and only God. This surah also deals with another important issue, and that is shirk. Makkans were mushrikun, they used to do shirk, and there were many ways for their shirk. One was idol worshipping. And over here in the third verse of the surah, Allah is dealing with another form of shirk, and that is the belief in the family members of Allah. Makkans used to believe that angels are female and all the angels are the daughters of Allah. So Allah rejected their concept over here, and Allah is saying, Lam yalid, he begets not. And in this phrase, Allah didn't reject only the Makkans, but Allah also rejected the belief of the Christians who believe in Jesus as the Son of God. And Allah also rejected the Jews who believed in Uzair alayhi salam as the Son of God. The Holy Quran says, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ عُزَيْرٌ ابْنُ اللَّهِ وَقَالَتِ النَّصَارَى الْمَسِيحُ ابْنُ اللَّهِ. Like the Jews said that Uzair is the Son of Allah, and Christians said that Masih is the Son of God. So Allah rejected all such people who believe in the family folk of Allah, saying, لَمْ يَلِدْ, he begets not. And Allah also said, وَلَمْ يُولَدْ, then nor is he begotten. Makkans used to ask Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, that who was there before Allah in power and authority, from whom Allah got this world as inheritance, and who is coming after Allah in power and authority. The same problem, comparison of Allah with mankind. As it happens on the earth that the father dies and his son takes place, he dies and his son takes place. So similarly, the thought that the same thing is happening in the heavens. So they were said that, وَلَمْ يُولَدْ, nor is he begotten. Allah is not the son of anyone to take the world as inheritance from him, because no one was there before Allah. Allah is the first and the last, wal awwal wal akhir. So when no one was there before Allah, so no one can be his father. So Allah rejected this thing that Allah has any physical relationship with anyone. He is pure from having these kind of relations. And this is a repeated theme of the Quran. In many other places, Allah has rejected this thing. Like in Surah Maryam, Allah says, وَقَالُوا اتَّخَذَ الرَّحْمَنُ وَلَدًا لَقَدْ جِئْتُمْ شَيْئًا إِدَّا. And they said, the Most Gracious has begotten a son. Indeed, you have brought forth something very terrible. And in Surah Najm, Allah said, أَلَكُمُ الذَّكَرُ وَلَهُ الْأُنْثَى تِلْكَ إِذًا قِسْمَةٌ ضِيزَى. For you only male and for Allah only female. It is very unjust division. Makkans disliked daughters, they used to bury them alive, and they liked only the sons. And for Allah, they didn't believe in any son, but they believed in countless angels as daughters of Allah. So Allah is saying that, for you only male and for Allah only female, it is very unjust division. So Allah didn't need even the sons, but Allah is making fun of the Makkans that look at your division. For yourself, you chose only sons, and for Allah, you chose only the daughters. And in the end of this surah, Allah is saying that وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. No one is like unto him. That the problem of shirk arises only when the people compare Allah with other beings. So whenever we will start the comparison of Allah with other beings, we will go towards shirk. So that's why Allah is saying, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. No one is like unto him. No one can be compared. No one can be matched with Allah. Allah's attributes are incomparable. We cannot even imagination about the greatness of Allah. So when we cannot imagine God, so how can we do the comparison of Allah with other beings? We should believe in him as a unique being who is beyond human imagination and comprehension. There are a few important lessons we should remember from this surah. First of all, it said that most important concept of Islam is Tawheed. So Muslims should be very, very conscious about this belief, and they must avoid all forms of shirk. And they should keep their beliefs pure in the Tawheed of Allah. And that is also the reason of this surah's name, Ikhlas. When we understand this surah, when we believe in this surah, it purifies our faith in Tawheed and it removes all the impurities of shirk. And secondly, Allah reminded us that He is Samad, who is the problem solver of the entire universe. So whenever we are in need of any kind of help, whenever we need any support from someone, so we should look towards Allah. No one loves humankind more than Allah. No one can understand our problems better than Allah. No one has more powers to solve our problems than God. So why should we go towards other beings for the solution of our problems? We should turn to God and we should seek only His support. That is the message of the Surah. Allah is Samad, and we should keep it in mind. And besides that, we should avoid believing in the family members of Allah. And it is too illogical as well to believe in the descendants of Allah, because need of a descendant is a sign of weakness. A person needs a descendant. He wants that he should have a son when he will become old, so he will become his helper. When he will die, he will inherit him his estates, and he will continue his mission like that. That's why the human beings need children and they need descendants. But Allah is not going to become old. Allah is not going to become weak. Allah has to go nowhere. He will remain with all of His power always. So it is illogical for Allah to have any kind of descendant. Besides that, it is also a rule of genetics that if someone has a child, offsprings always take the characteristics of their parents. For example, the goat will give birth only to a goat. Obviously, all the features of the kids of the goat will be like his mother. So if Allah has any child, as the Christians believe that Jesus is the Son of God, so Jesus should have the characteristics of Allah in him. But we see that the characteristics of Allah are not present in anyone. The attributes of Allah are not found in anyone else other than God. The Holy Quran says in Surah Maida about Isa and Maryam alayhim as-salam, Kana ya'kulani ta'am. They used to take food. So the one who takes food, the one who needs food, who needs rest, so how can he be a part of from God, and how can he be descendant of Allah when he has the attributes totally different from the God's attributes? So it is illogical to believe in the family folk of Allah. We need to believe in Allah as the one and only God, and we should preserve the concept of Tawheed very carefully, because if we will do something like shirk, so all of our deeds will go in vain and Allah will reject all of our efforts on the judgment day. Because the only thing which Allah has announced in the Holy Quran that which will remain unforgivable, that is shirk. The Holy Quran says, إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء, that Allah forgives not ascribing partners with Him, and He forgives what else He wishes. Allah becomes so sensitive in the matter of shirk because it is a matter of His own position, it is a matter of His honor. Even a human does not compromise in the matter of his honor. So how Allah, the one and only God, can compromise if a person is believing someone equal to him, or if a person is giving the attributes of Allah to someone else? May Allah save us from all forms of shirk, and may Allah keep us on the belief of Tawheed. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.